Thank you, Norman. I just want to begin my remarks by noting that we have a new chief of staff in the White House. And one of my concerns over these last many years of our campaigns, of our wars in the Middle East, of our what really is the most accurate way, our slaughter of many, many people in the Middle East, has been the misrepresentation and the misunderstanding of what drives many of the actors, many of the men and women who are fighting us in the Middle East. General Kelly has on numerous occasions stated that this is a war about our way of life. However, in my positions, particularly when I was in the State Department with access to top secret information and access to the interrogations of men that we would capture who had joined Al-Qaeda in Iraq and the Islamic State in Iraq, it was clear that these men who were traveling to Iraq and Afghanistan to fight us, as well as what we know from those people who have carried out terror attacks in Europe, as well as in the United States, including the 9/11 hijackers, in their martyrdom videos, or in their notes, or what have you, their motivations are clear. They are not saying convert or die. They are not saying we hate your freedom. They are not saying we are doing this because your girls are going to school or because your women are wearing dresses above the knees. They are saying this. They are saying we are conducting these attacks because you are bombing our countries, because your militaries are present in our countries, because you are supporting dictatorships, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So there is this misunderstanding, this misconstruing. I think it's very intentional on some points. Some of it is based on ignorance, and much of it is done to drive nationalism and to drive the spirit of war. I will say this also ties greatly into what Norman was speaking about earlier, the dangers of a war between the United States and Russia. And of course, if anyone has been reading the New York Times recently, you will see the coverage in the New York Times over the large U.S. military exercises, the large NATO exercises being conducted on Russia's borders. We also remember Russia has been the victim of three major invasions in the last 150 years or so, losing tens of millions of people. However, the New York Times finds it fit to characterize Russia conducting military training within its own borders as aggression. So that is the first of my concerns that I'd like to address within my allotted time here about why it's so very, very important for us to get these American aircraft out of the skies of Syria, because we are on the brink of war with Russia. And it is something that I don't think the people in Washington, D.C. can quite understand what that war would be like. The second reason is more of a moral reason, and it's more of a reason that has got to do with the fact that simply that the United States air campaigns, the United States air warfare, maybe, or in my estimation, is the greatest moral and human hazard of the last century. Certainly, if you start with this is the 72nd anniversary of the bombings of Nagasaki and Hiroshima, something that nearly all American four-star and five-star generals after World War II said was not a military necessity. Was done for strictly political reasons. If you go into the understanding that most Americans do not know, but all North Koreans certainly know, that the American Air Force burned down nearly every village and town in North Korea, that in Vietnam we dropped more bombs on the Vietnamese than we did on the Japanese or on the Germans in terms of tonnage, and we conducted the largest chemical warfare program in the history of the world against the Vietnamese, something that millions of people are still sickened with, something that there will be babies born today with deformities because of. If we fast forward, of course, to the results of our air campaigns that the Iraqis certainly are still paying for, certainly that the Libyans are still paying for, that the Afghans are still paying for, and for which there has been no results that anyone can point to say this has been of benefit, then certainly how can anyone say that the air campaign being conducted by the United States is a sane, rational, or moral response? When I first started speaking publicly against the wars in 2009, I was asked, well, you've been in both, you served in both, you were in both, and I hate saying served, that's the incorrect word to use, I feel. You were in both Iraq and Afghanistan. What were the similarities? What were the differences between the two? And I fell into that trap. But then after a bit of time, I said, wait, what am I doing? There's only one thing that matters. The United States military is in both locations, and you can only expect one outcome. You're absolutely insane if you think anything different is going to happen. And that is the same thing that will happen with the American air campaign in Syria. If anyone thinks anything different will occur to the people of Syria from an American air campaign that's already been, as Norman noted, 3 years in progress, then they are completely naive, foolish, or have another agenda. And this is not to say that Bashar Assad has not been a dictator, was not born from the father of a dictator, you know, his father was not a dictator, has not committed war crimes himself. This is not to excuse that. I'm not here as an apologist for the Syrian government, but I am telling you that American airstrikes in Syria are not the solution and are a continuing moral hazard for all people of Syria, just as they have been for the people of Korea, Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, Libya, Pakistan. And interestingly enough, if you've seen the news recently, the American military is now looking or is interested in launching airstrikes into the Philippines. So nearly 120 years after we first began our military campaign against the Filipinos, we are looking to continue it. So I appreciate you all being here today, and I thank you all for your time.